in an errand and she talks to me.
One day in June 1983, President Reagan met with his national security advisors. During the meeting, Reagan put down his notes, looked around, and asked, "Has anyone seen War Games?" No one had. The movie had only just come out. Reagan explained that in the film, a teenager hacks into the North American Air Defense Command computer and accidentally triggers an escalation between the USSR and the US, almost causing a nuclear war. He then turned to General John Vesey, chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff, and asked, "General, could this really happen? Could someone really break into our most secure computers?" The next week, General Vesey came back to Reagan and said, "The problem is much worse than you think." 18 months later, Reagan issued the first presidential directive on computer security. Today, we might think that the need to ensure the security of such important computer systems was self-evident, but it wasn't. It took two young screenwriters, Lawrence Lasker and Walter F. Parks, to portray the growing vulnerability of nuclear weapons systems on film before the government paid attention to it. That year, tensions between the nuclear superpowers were high. The situation worsened when the Soviet Union shot down a South Korean commercial airliner, and again when NATO's Able Archer War Games exercise was mistaken for a real threat. That same year, another film debuted that would raise public awareness of nuclear risk, influence Cold War policy, and ultimately improve the safety of the world. The Day After. A film about the aftermath of nuclear war was conceived by Brandon Stoddard, ABC's Vice President of Motion Pictures for Television, written by Edward Hume, and directed by Nicholas Meyer. The original broadcast was seen by an estimated 100 million Americans. The film profoundly impacted public opinion about nuclear war. Its realistic depiction of the devastation of such a war renewed debates about proliferation and galvanized support for disarmament. The Day After was also privately screened for the Joint Chiefs of Staff. According to a government advisor who was present, it turned them to stone. In his memoirs, Reagan drew a direct line between seeing the film and signing the landmark Intermediate Range Nuclear Forces Treaty in 1987, which vastly reduced the nuclear arsenals of both the United States and the Soviet Union.
Nuclear war cannot be won and must never be fought.
The Day After remains relevant because, as long as we have nuclear weapons, we live under the threat of nuclear war. War Games has a lot to say about today's world, too, as well as breaking new ground by spotlighting the emerging threats of hackers to nuclear security. It foreshadowed today's AI landscape with its portrayal of an advanced AI system training itself to master games and make its own decisions. The film even explored the highly current issue of how rushing to integrate unpredictable AI into military frameworks could blur lines of judgment and lead to unintended rapid escalations. But above all, despite their stark differences in genre and tone, War Games, offering a teen techno-thriller, and The Day After, delivering a poignant human drama, both films underscored the grave dangers of nuclear conflict. Their narratives not only resonated with the public, but also helped to shape policy, and thus reduce the risk of nuclear war. A war which, according to recent research, could create a nuclear winter capable of killing up to 5 billion people. Today, the 2023 Future of Life Award celebrates Walter F. Parks and Lawrence Lasker, the screenwriters of War Games, and Brandon Stoddard, the visionary behind The Day After, along with its screenwriter Edward Hume and director Nicholas Meyer. The work of these filmmakers showcases how storytelling can shift the collective consciousness and influence the course of history for the better.